all the attention. Yeah.
Squeaky wheel. Great. So the engine. The engine experiment as it started, as John started it in November and December, wrote a huge amount of code. A large portion of that has survived. It's all in the package, the experimental package. One thing, though, is that it has become fairly obvious to me that the engine, the actual like core of everything that was in that package, is the thing that we'll ship first. And a lot of the other experiments in there related, in particular, related to target layouts, we can make independent decisions about, essentially. The engine is a way to execute things. And in particular, I'm kind of starting with integration. How I expect we will integrate, as I mentioned it earlier, is that Bootstrap and CodeGen will move into the new engine and replace synthetic targets. So synthetic targets will not be able to make synthetic targets. And so then anything that creates synthetic targets needs to happen upfront. Then the graph stays the same for the rest of the pants run. And so what that means is that can happen mostly transparently. It's possible that we can do it without changing any, like without breaking any APIs except the build graph, a few methods on the build graph itself. So via deprecations of those methods, we might be able to actually ship that as 1.3 or something rather than calling it 2.0. The inject synthetic target methods. If you instead say like use simple code gen, then and you are installed in gen, then that phase will run. It's not entirely nailed down, but it all seems relatively feasible.
I like the idea of having like a point at which you're done modifying the graph, at which point the graph is frozen.
Yeah.
Because that would provide a convenient place for us to like shim in like remote execution, like mm-hmm. especially remote Scala compilation using the existing daemon.
Right.
You could see those kind of like converging.
Yeah. Okay. Well, right. And so then the idea is once you've done that, more and more tasks, any tasks that haven't been ported in, so you have two phases to every build. One is like the new engine runs, and then the existing engine runs all front-end tasks.
Define front-end.
Where a front-end task is anything that is just consuming the graph, and that is initially everything, right? Anything that is not mutating the graph is just consuming it and continues to use the product maps. To use the product maps until they don't need to, right? At some point, front-end tasks are things that don't create products, but that's only when everything that does create products has been pushed into the new engine. So, if that makes sense. But I think it's possible to launch this fairly incrementally. The only thing that we can't launch fairly incrementally is the build file manipulation or the build file refactor that we potentially want to do. And so I think as more of this is integrated, we can potentially at the next summit say, here's what we want to do to build files, and we'll call it 2.0 or something, or not. Okay, so let's talk about what has happened. I'm going to talk briefly about selectors because they're kind of important. So the idea behind a selector is you have no docs. That's what you have. Let's look at an example. So you have usages of selectors. A selector selects the dependencies. And this is a bit overloaded because there's actually a selector called select dependencies. It selects the arguments to a function. The function recursive subdirectories. Let's not jump to one that involves recursion. Let's start something simpler. Okay, so this is super simple. There is a function, merge paths, and it takes the dependencies, it takes as an argument, only one argument, right? This list here is the argument list. It's going to take the result of this selector matching, right? And so when this selector matches, this merge paths is able to run. And this is the return type. So the return type of merge paths is a paths object, and this is a product. Things are not, well, sorry, we use product a lot. It's the type. This is all type driven. So the output of this is a paths object, and that type is what keys it into any other tasks that might be installed.
Same with the arguments, the select dependencies,
these right.
products I need, select.
Yeah, so a simpler one is perhaps here. Dang. Okay, so looking at this one, there's a select literal, ignore that for a second. Select paths means if, okay, sorry, one thing to clarify. A selector runs in the context of a particular subject. So assume that there is a subject here. So in the context of this subject, can I get paths for the subject?
Okay. What is the subject?
Targets.
It can be anything.
Okay.
Anything for which I can compute paths, okay. I can generate files content for. Because it's not the subject that I care about. It's the paths. It's the argument that I care about.
Right.
So this is disconnected from the context in which I'm running, but essentially the reason the subject is not something explicit here is anything that I can generate paths for, regardless of what it is, I can run for, because all I need is the paths. So the subject here, in particular, it may actually be a paths object. The subject may be a paths object, in which case you can trivially say, yes, I can get paths for a paths object, right? So I can run.
So subject is something that provides a
it can.
Type of product?
It can, but it may be the input, right? So the question then becomes, if the product is not a paths object, or I'm sorry, if the subject is not a paths object in this context, is there anything that can give me a paths object for a files glob object or a globs object, right? So if you imagine that you hit this function in the context of a globs object, I would look up, are there any functions that can give me a paths object for a globs object?
So the subject is completely the preview of the scheduler above you. You never really need to worry about that.
Yeah. The subject, right. And so those are selectors. And so how that works is selects the given product for the subject provided to the constructor. So essentially,
and they're required by default, optionally.
Yeah, optional. Optional is only used in one place in the whole thing, and I'm not sure it's going to survive. It's currently used for goals, because when I say compile, I don't necessarily want Python sources and Java sources for all. Well, no, sorry. If I say gen is a better example. If I use the gen goal, it selects each of those products optionally and then fails if it doesn't get any of them.
Yeah.
I don't know. So that's going to have to change a little bit. But selects the given product for the subject provided to the constructor. So when I have that, what I end up doing is, okay, my subject is, I don't know. My subject is, I don't care, right? It's some object. This selector is saying, if I can get paths for that subject, whatever it is, I can run. And so the subject doesn't really play into this. In many cases, this is going to run because the subject is a paths object. But in other cases, I have to run other computations in order to get a paths object. And then I can get you files content if you want them. So next is.
So basically, it tells you how to get the files content from a paths.
Yeah, that's what it boils down to. Given these inputs, I can generate this thing. Where did the inputs come from? I don't know. And like, so this doesn't mean necessarily that the subject is a paths object. It just means if I can get one
right.
for this subject, whether it is one or not, then I can run.
Select literal.
So select literal is. I was going to do these in order of frequency, but this is sort of frequency order. It is unfortunately one of the weirdest ones, and it may not live very long. So select literal is currently the escape hatch for getting a literal object. It's not being computed anywhere.
You know the object you want to operate
on. I know, yeah, here is the object. And it is the way currently, so this files content is a pickleable top level function up here, sitting here. And so it cannot refer to a floaty static project tree. It needs to get one from somewhere. And so during setup, you register a select literal that already knows the subject that it's going to use. So given this subject A, the select literal is going to say, I don't care about subject A. I know that in order to be satisfied, I need this product for this other subject. And so it always runs for the subject key that was already configured, right? There's an input, but I'm ignoring it. Yeah. Doesn't matter what you're trying to generate this product for. I'm just going to use this input I already had. So it's a little weird.
So this might be used for tool class paths?
It's used,
for example, where you configure.
The examples that live are good examples, I think. Project tree. Project tree is the file system. I need a handle to the file system. Other examples
would it be
of like
true to say that this potentially would be how subsystems would be handled?
Yes. So probably select literal gets replaced with subsystem.
Yes.
And one word I throw around a lot is the idea of a native node. Currently, this is just working via select node. And select node is this generic thing that can select a product for a subject and does the is-a check. And then if it can't, you know, requests using tasks some conversion. But probably for something like select literal, we want some native node where I can look at the graph and say that is a subsystem, not that is a select literal for some type. This is a subsystem. So subsystems will probably need to exist explicitly in the graph soon. So going back up to the original examples that John had written, they now look like this. I'm going to ignore that for a little bit. So Gen Scrooge Thrift can give you Java sources given thrift sources. A Scrooge Java configuration with a variant thrift and the Scrooge tool address key. Given a class path for the Scrooge tool address.
So it is being used. Okay.
Yeah, so in that case, yes. Okay. Touche. Other cases of select literal, like here, it's getting a source roots thing. This is very explicitly like a subsystem-y, like I'm getting a subsystem. But you can think of it as, so everything is DI'd in the sense that I have to declare that I need it, otherwise I can't get it.
Is there an algebra yet?
We
had talked about like an OR, like combinators for these, or is it literally these three things or this one thing or these two things? That's it.
Yeah. You can say that an argument is optional, in which case it can be satisfied with none. Yeah, that's the only place.
Cool.
This is and. So this list is and. I need all three arguments. Yeah. They are the parameters to my function.
Yeah.
So now if I want to generate, let's say it's not Scrooge, just my question, I'd say it's like regular Apache compiler, right? So you have a stanza that looks exactly like that for Java, a stanza that looks exactly like that for Python, and for every language that sort of can generate.
Currently. Yes, it can be. One example where we do that currently, which is a bit odd, but works. Is in graph. Here we go. Okay, so this is the strange special case. For any product, in the symbol table class, i.e. anything that I can literally put in a build file, I can create, I shouldn't have pointed to this example. But anyway, this is how you would, this is a nasty special case, but this is how you would multiply that out, right? It's still the case that I can generate these multiple types, and I'd still have to define a type if I wanted another language. I'd need a sources type currently.
Right, I guess my question is, do we need a Java sources and a Python sources and a Scala sources, or do we need a single sources type that is parameterized on the language?
That one is...
That's where you started.
For simplicity, I moved toward types only. Mm-hmm. So types are essentially the only selector currently. It could be a type factory. But I moved toward just types, and it could have just been sources of. The reason was...
I totally buy that it's easier to reason about for now, because
the reason I ended up changing it was because in a build file, there were actually two sources of. There was sources of for the purposes of product calculation, and then but when you got it out of a build file, you got a concrete sources object,
right,
which had no type, and I needed to connect the types.
In either way, like in the case of Apache Thrift, mm-hmm. Extension does not map. You would need still the list, eight strings of the eight strings you need to support anyway, because in some cases the gem key for Thrift matches the extension, in some cases it doesn't.
Yeah, there's no reason why you couldn't do property. There's no reason why you couldn't do property matches on in selectors. I just haven't needed to yet.
I mean, just to give a more even more trivial example, there's some rule in here that to get class files you need to source files.
But that's very specific to the types. Yeah.
Right, but you could imagine eight different JVM languages that will need to repeat that.
No, it's not. In that case, it definitely wouldn't be repeated because the compiler is different. Like the function that runs is different each time.
Yeah.
And I liked your little for comprehension there. Like that's
clean way of like, right. Even given types, you can generate the different conversions with I need this input for that output. And install those all as different tasks. I think that type could be synthetic for sure. What was I going to do? Let me go back to what I was trying to do. Okay, so the selectors, there's a few more. Select dependencies is really critical. Select dependencies and select projection are both kind of critical. What select dependencies does is for the right-hand side is the depths product. First, if I can get a paths object for the current subject, request an address family for each of its members. So that's what select dependencies does.
What's a subject's member?
Dependencies member. And this takes an argument. What this is implicitly is dependencies.
Yep.
So on this paths object, there is a field called dependencies.
The list
paths.dependencies. For each of those, request an address family. So this fans out into a select node for get me an address family for this.
For all the dependencies of paths.
Right, for all the members of paths. And so in FS, there's another example, which is here. Okay, so for a directory listing with the field directories, for each directory in a directory listing, get recursive subdirectories. And so this is recursion happening. So what happens is, given a path, again, implicitly there's a subject here, right? Probably in this case, the subject is a path. In my mind, I still have trouble wrapping my mind around this, and I apologize, but select path is means there's probably a path available, or this is a thing that I can compute a path for. I can compute a path for this subject, okay? I can also compute a directory listing for this subject, right? So both of those apply to path. But given those two things, given a directory listing, request recursive subdirectories for each of its directories. And so the definition of recursive subdirectories is request recursive subdirectories for each directory in the path, right? So this triggers recursion, right? Because eventually this is going to find a directory listing that is empty. Yep. And so that dependency is a no op. So that one runs, then it runs, it walks back up. And so I can try to, you can see this happening if I do, of course, that doesn't work for,
so you have six monitors now, it works side by side.
No. What do you mean?
For the graphs.
Oh, for the graphs, yeah, it's huge. Yeah. I need a good example of...
You need a trackpad so you can side-scroll. That's the trick.
This is a less sexy example. The reason that didn't work is because I tried to compile something without any variants present. But essentially, at the root, what we try to do is... You have the sibling addresses, which maps from colon, right?
Oh, okay.
So that's a sibling addresses object. If I did this, I'd get descendant addresses.
Right.
So I have it, the subject is a sibling addresses. As one of the special cases on types, the engine is aware that for sibling addresses and addresses and single addresses, it could get multiple entries. I'll show that. It's not too much of a special case. But so it ends up requesting... give me a second.
What was the goal here? Like depth map or something?
Where is sibling even defined? Sibling, okay. So for the directory in a sibling addresses, generate a path and then request an address family. So that's less exciting. So this basically just gets the addresses for a sibling addresses object. The special case though is here, which is for, so this is the extent of the special casing for CLI args. If the type is one of single address, sibling addresses, or descendant addresses, assume we might get multiple out.
That makes sense.
And request an addresses object, right? Mm-hmm. So it's basically, if we've gotten something on the CLI, we don't even know whether it exists. And so we first convert to an addresses object. So the idea is the first thing we requested was an addresses object. And then for every member of that addresses object, we want this product, whatever it happens to be. I asked for compile, so this is going to request a class path for every entry here, and there were two. There's Scala library and Guava. How was that computed? Well, that was computed based on getting an address family for the sibling addresses, which, using a projection node, is actually requesting one for a direct... Oh, no, we're not there yet. For a... path, right? So for this path, get me an address family. So I've got my address family with objects, and that results in the address. Oops, sorry. No, that results in a return value of an address family for this sibling addresses object. Part of the reason for the projection is that if 1,000 different paths lead to a particular directory listing, the subject is actually part of the key for a node. And so by projecting, I say rather than requesting this and making this a unique thing, rather than reparsing the address family for each distinct sibling addresses object, for example, it's actually the directory that matters. And so you can see this links into this single object, which has multiple inbound nodes, right? The address family for a path is used in a few different places, right? We needed an address family in order to unhydrate it, or I'm sorry, in order to get a struct out of the build file, we needed that address family as well. And so we needed the address family for this path. Okay, so projection is a little bit hard to explain. What's a good example of projection?
I mean, it sounds like you're memoizing a calculation, but obviously there's something.
It is. To it. So it is memoization of a calculation. The idea, though, is that when I'm computing, if there are 1,000 different ways to enter a particular subgraph, the key for the memoization is something less specific than each of those 1,000 ways.
So projection is literally saying project
this field.
Okay.
Yeah, it's the directory field is the only thing that matters here to the identity of this input.
Okay.
And so when you select...
Otherwise, it's all properties. Like if you don't do a projection, the implicit assumption is uniqueness is based on...
Yes, it's everything. Okay. Yeah, right. So projecting means request it over here and it will cause... Right. So the memoization in this case is going to happen for the projected field.
Yeah.
It will also happen for this field, but the idea is that you wouldn't cache it for projections, for example.
Okay.
Okay. Let's go back in here. So I kind of explained how file system walks worked, right? Because recursively we're requesting something. And actually, oh, I have list. Duh. That's why this didn't work. So compile is not going to work here, but list is going to work. So it's a lot of stuff, right?
So now our walks are obviously parallelized as much mm-hmm. as they can be.
If you swap out, if you use the parallel engine, then the walk is parallel, yeah. So this... is based on, we have an address family for this directory, address family for this directory, et cetera. And recursively, we got recursive subdirectories and then requested address families for them, which resulted in, at the very top, addresses, recursively containing all the addresses. And then list is just requesting that address.
What's return?
The return type...
That's all that is. That's just
this is literally this return. Yeah, and this is the toString of an address object. Okay. So we got an address object, and then a dependencies node, because it is a fanout, always results in a list of inputs, and so the result here is a list of the addresses. Now, if you were to look at this as it's executing, the very first thing it does is request this object. It can't know that it needs to request these objects, right? So the first thing it does is request this object. Once it has it, and okay, now let's get into nodes. So how this execution actually happens is nodes. So node is a class with a step method. Now, the idea behind nodes is that they are not user-facing. Everything I've shown you so far is user-facing. Selectors are user-facing. Functions are obviously user-facing. Functions needing to DI things, that's all user-facing. But now we're actually getting into the engine itself. So this is internal. This is an internal API. I don't expect there to be very many types of nodes. Currently, there's a select node, dependencies node, projection node, and task node. We expect that there will also be an FS node, where FS node is a node that we recognize we need to cache and validate, and maybe a subsystem node, but maybe not. I don't know. We might find some other solution there.
Potentially a sub-process node?
And for invoking a process, a sub-process, that would be a separate node as well, most likely. But the idea is to have as few of these as possible, because they are where the meat of this. Actually, it's where the imperative part happens.
Yeah.
Right. Because selectors so far are completely declarative.
Yep.
Right. So user tasks cannot run arbitrary stuff. Except in the sense that
the function
file exists could call os.blah instead.
We'll sandbox that someday.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. But it's totally possible to sandbox that. But these nodes, on the other hand, are things that pants developers would implement. Users don't know they exist, ideally. Instead, they use selectors to create these nodes. Step is the API for node, right? Given a dict of the dependencies for the node, return the current state of the node. So basically, so I need to rename that. This is actually a step context.
But the scheduler or whatever instantiates basically a node per select behind the scenes.
Yeah. So the selector is essentially a constructor for a node.
Yeah.
So the idea is execution is based on stepping nodes until all nodes have reached either return, throw, or no op. And the alternative to returning return, throw, or no op is to return waiting. Well, actually, so as it says, after this method returns a non-waiting state, it will never be visited again. So the idea is if you need additional dependencies, you indicate that you're waiting for them. So the very first execution for any node is going to have an empty dependencies list. And the vast majority of nodes are going to say, I need this in order to run. So you step them once with no dependencies. If you already have that computed value, you step them again with the computed value as a dependency state. But you have to explicitly introduce the dependency in order to be handed it. You won't just receive random dependency states, only ones that you've previously said that you need come in.
Why don't I understand the purpose of that first call?
The purpose of the first, because we don't know what you need.
So this class that implements node is declaratively saying what it needs?
Tasks are. Yes. The tasks are declaratively saying what they need. And so in theory, from this clause on a task node, you could figure that out. But what the task node does is do that. So the task node figures out what it declares the nodes it needs and then returns them. The reason for this API, though, the reason you have this API where a node can step multiple times before finalizing is that things like dependencies node, they do not recurse themselves, but they have a two-step process, right? In particular, the first thing you do is request the product you need in order to get the dependencies, right? So for every directory in a directory listing, get a recursive subdirectory, right? First, we need the directory listing. So the first thing a dependencies node does is select the directory listing, right? We need to know what we need.
Yeah.
So the first thing we do is we bounce out, we get that dependency. Once we have it, we request those. So that is the reason for the step API almost entirely. First, get the directory listing so that I can do this other thing.
Where is it getting? But the directory listing is not a product now?
It is a product. Yeah. So the first thing you do is that you select this dep product node is this thing.
I see.
So for my subject, request the dep product.
So why isn't the directory listing just a product dependency of?
It is.
What are you trying to get here?
Yeah. So you could...
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good point. I think you could skip... You could skip... Oh, one reason is we're trampolining, and so we're trampolining in and out of these nodes. If it were, if you trivially just had every node had a list of its initial dependencies or like known dependencies, they would all end up linked to one another as opposed to being in the graph. So you could have a separate API that is, I'll call you and you tell me what you depend on, but then that's approximately step. And so I just kind of unified it, I guess.
Those feel a lot like futures.
Yeah.
It feels a lot like it's implementing kind of a future API. In
right.
In particular, it feels very much like step could be a coroutine where you're yielding the dependencies that you want satisfied,
mm-hmm.
and then you just get the result back.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then like the engine is kind of like an IO loop that like is spinning these things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, if you can support shipping a coroutine somewhere else before running it, then yeah. So if you can pickle the coroutine and then send it, yeah, totally. And I think some people have pointed out that so this you can you almost certainly want to do with futures. Like and I'm totally fine with that refactor if that ends up looking cleaner. One thing to be clear about though is this is our API. The end user API has zero exposure to concurrency because they don't run at all until their inputs are there. So yeah. So what we do in here, we can do whatever we want. Users don't think about this.
Right. Yeah.
Which is, I think, good.
I just mean for our own sanity.
Yeah. I'm fine with that. So another just as prior art, what Basil does is. The equivalent here to what this has ended up as is Skyframe. And Skyframe is a similar execution model, except it's based on tasks running until they need a thing. Calling on the context, I need this thing. And if they can't get it, returning null. But that is the end user API. I don't know. But this is a similar situation, except it's a little bit more explicit.
I think what a coroutine helps you do here is it lets you write this without having to take into account the fact that you're gonna run through the first part, and then run through it again, run through the second part.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah,
mm-hmm.
Like instead of return waiting, you would yield.
Yeah.
And then,
you need to get the input.
Iterating the step, right? It's called step, right?
So if it needs to be one of those bi-directional coroutines.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
So,
which are not in Python 2.
Sure.
They're in 3 or 2?
No, Python 2, you can
return
a
passive
value.
There's a backport. So instead of like yield from, it's like yield and then class from.
Okay. Yeah.
You don't get the same exact syntax, but it's similar.
I think I'd probably be fine with.
Not to mention
one
your engine
here. One issue though. One
yeah.
issue. So yes, Pickle probably supports that. But do other serialization frameworks? So it's like it's. There are a few considerations here, and one of the things is that this is very shippable.
Yeah.
Because
so
this is stateless
yeah.
between executions. So yeah, coroutines are good, but we have to be.
So
step is not.
So, I mean, I would think a
general... The node is utterly stateless,
like,
yeah.
You have the function,
so
and you have, like, some sort of, like, metadata one. Like, it tells you, like, where you are in the generator.
It can, but self is immutable.
Yeah,
so this date... One thing
like,
I... This is in core now.
It's certainly something to look into. Yeah.
Data type is a name tuple.
Yep.
Data type is a name tuple that includes the type.
Yeah.
And that's because I chased a bug for a long time where I had two tuples that were of length 5 and they were equal. But of different types.
Yeah,
so data type includes the type, and that's all. But it's immutable, and so this has no anything. It has no actual state on it. The first time you run, you're probably only going to make it... you will definitely only make it to here.
You could add an in the cap state. Like, it's not obvious to the author of one of the I know that those are running us,
but yeah.
It's not obvious that you can't store state on
yeah.
these things for the
no,
extent.
I'm totally happy to refactor the crap out of this. It's also possible that each of these nodes should live somewhere. Currently, how it works is if you had four processes, the scheduler would take the output from a step and then probably launch the next iteration of the step on some other node, right?
Right.
No, so you
no
guarantee.
Right.
Yep. You have no guarantee that the next iteration
what?
Will
with node
loads.
Being overloaded here.
Yeah.
Machine.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the next iteration of step with these, there's a consequence of the current one.
Mm-hmm.
May run on a different object. May run on a different
right.
machine.
Right.
May,
yeah.
Like,
and it's that. That's actually
it's
a really interesting point because I hadn't.
It's kind of a gotcha in on this piece.
Well,
of
and it may, and I'd.
Document,
I'd never thought of that. Well, there is no. Yeah. I mean.
Well, you can add them, right?
Yeah.
I don't think it's a big deal because I think. Like even like plugin developers are not writing
yeah.
these, so
there's also some small yeah. There's some small bit of enforcement, which is that if you did, your state would just disappear. Because during the pickling like you've been pickled across and you changed yourself on the other side, but then coming back, I don't send the whole step back, I just send back the step ID and the result. And so that object, well, that's nice that you changed it.
Oh, so it's always, even if...
That would flush out bugs of that form.
So
yeah.
If you're running on a single machine, it still gets serialized and then rehydrated.
For multiprocessing, yeah.
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 Even like
because to cross...
A single machine example, you would still do that.
Yeah.
For to cross process boundaries.
So that would pretty quickly expose that.
Yeah, you'd... Yeah. Yeah, it's been great having that in there. Okay, so that's Node, and that is the reason for the step API. This can introduce dependencies. And the reason it can introduce dependencies is it allows for parsing build files. It also allows for, you know, doing all kinds of other stuff. You just don't know ahead of time what your dependencies will be.
I'm still a little curious about in that step function that the comment is request the product we need in order to request dependencies, and it's not clear to me why that needs to be done inside this function when that seems like a generic thing. Like this object is declaring
there could be another yes.
This whole thing when you say get self, you know, get product mode equals
yeah.
this, and get product state equals the state of that thing, and then if get product state is none,
right.
we're waiting. That seems like boilerplate that would be repeated in every implementation of step.
No, because not everything has other dependencies. So if that method existed, it would only be used by dependencies node and projection node. Projection node does something similar. It's requests this thing in order to project its field.
Mm-hmm.
Task node, on the other hand, doesn't have any. It just, it computes the task nodes that it's going to request and it immediately requests them. I guess the way to think about that would be that has only the first half. So task node has only the first half. Like I can deterministically compute my dependency nodes, and so I could just run. Select node, on the other hand, can't, because the first thing select node does is say, is this a if the subject is a product or has a product, then we're done, right? We just return it. And there are no dependencies for a select node if the subject is of the right type. So basically, it would move some logic outside of step. I'm happy to refactor that, and I think...
I think the important thing here is like this code is still constantly kind of evolving and changing,
right.
And there will be a point where it'll move from... Currently, it's behind the EXP or experimental boundary, and at some point it'll move back, and then we'll have a chance to go through full code.
Yeah, I don't intuit this anywhere near enough to actually critique it. It's more
right.
I'm curious as to what the boundaries between the declarative part and the programmatic part. Like,
this is entirely private. This is us.
Yeah, and there's
right.
and the fact that there are only
users
five
cannot touch this. Right.
Makes me not worry so much about...
Users cannot touch this, so we can refactor the shit out of it. The selectors, and in fact, I want to go a little bit further. Selectors currently has a dependency on nodes because it constructs them.
Uh-huh.
It, like, there's a method here. So if you try to do the OO thing of, like, this thing knows how to construct the thing it needs to. If you delete this...
You need to break that.
Yeah, if you break this, and instead you have that be a type match somewhere else, this is completely private. It doesn't know about nodes.
Right.
This is the user-facing API. It doesn't have a dependencies on the internal API at all.
Okay.
So I broke that out. Selectors are public API. Nodes are not at all. And in fact, the fact that these are in here, this is bad. Well, no, it's not, because these aren't public either.
Right.
Those are for node. The public API, like the file system graph packages are the user API.
So how do I write like a custom
task? Exactly like the file system. Like this is a custom task. Like file system,
yeah.
this is a custom task.
You're going to end up with like a register pi that has these things
right.
defined in
you
it.
You can think of
with the functions mappings
at the bottom of these. It's just a rough pattern.
I also that function, right?
You offer this.
Call by the side.
Yeah,
yes.
You can think of this as this is just the dumb proxy for register pi.
Yeah.
Right. Here's some tasks.
Yeah.
Install them.
So that registers a task, and then eventually task node will be in charge of executing.
Yeah. But I have no idea about that. Completely private.
Sounds good.
This is what I wrote.
Yeah, so I can mentally wrap that tuple in a task install. Say it was a named tuple. So each of these is a task.
These are all data types. Yeah, so they're named tuples.
Yeah.
What about install?
I'm saying to make it more clear.
Mm-hmm.
So literally,
these
tuples instead of being bare tuples could be named tuples called task install.
They should be. Yeah.
Or whatever.
Yeah. Their task definition or
register
task descriptor. It should be.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
It
yes.
should be. Because the other thing is, it's going to need a scope.
What's a scope?
Maybe it won't need a scope.
Scope?
Maybe it doesn't.
Okay.
I don't know.
Okay.
No, maybe it doesn't. Maybe subsystems are the only thing that needs scopes, right? Because the select literal is how you. I'm getting a subsystem here, right? And so I don't need an identity. It does. But I don't. So I don't need a scope.
Or these things could almost even just become like a class implementation. And so you could say like this is file exists and then define like some class variables to define the things it needs. And then the implementation would be like a standard endpoint or something.
Yeah. I John had the ability to have this be a subclass of task.
Yeah.
And I just in order to kind of force the functional aspect and not allow for more method, I was just like, let's not do this.
Pull the backup if you need it.
It makes sense.
Yeah.
But you can imagine like the nice wrapper to like an end user being.
Yeah, like task descriptor or something like that.
Right now.
It should be.
It totally makes sense.
But left-hand side output. Yeah. Left-hand side is output. Middle is input.
Yeah.
End is function.
Yeah.
Maybe that should be better, but task descriptor. So that is the user-facing API entirely. One interesting thing, perhaps, is legacy. So now I'm getting into... we've done file system, we've done nodes and selectors, various endpoints. Let's talk about one of those. So John has had the visualizer.
What do you mean by endpoint?
Yeah. So entry points. So entry points... this is not a particularly good entry point to look at. The visualizer does for these example planners that John wrote a similar thing to what this commands package does for legacy. But planners is essentially an entire alternate universe of build properties, Apache Thrift, jars, class paths, compilers. It's everything. And so the tasks at the bottom are everything specific to this universe. Over here, though, in commands, we have different tasks. It uses the FS tasks. It uses the graph tasks. You might call these like struct, maybe. This is for parsing structs from build files, not a graph per se.
Build graph.
Yeah. And then legacy graph tasks. So given those things, dependencies, right? All of the tasks that I want to install are these legacy graph tasks, which I'll show you in a second, file system tasks, and graph tasks. The first thing I did was snapshot the inputs. And you can think of this as like initializing the subsystems. This subject's dict is content addressable. All subjects, you've seen subject keys. So all subjects are pickled currently. And then SHA-1. And that is their key. So I now have a content addressable key for this file system. That's what I give to the tasks. So what the FS tasks get are, here's a key to get a project tree at some point. Other benefit of that is that it's one way, so you can't have it except in the context of the execution environment. But anyway, the point of the content addressability is that return values that are identical across multiple nodes hit the cache in the same way. So full in, it's essentially what Patrick was proposing about the multi-level cache. What a multi-level cache boils down to is content addressability for the members. And then the second level key is to actually...
Yeah. So I think I see what you're saying, that...
Each return value is identified by its content.
The return value is
execution
by the content,
is the hash of the inputs and the function, essentially.
Right.
So it's the multi-level cache key.
And the other thing that I was proposing is that you have... you also have a secondary map from just... input hash key
right.
to output
yeah.
hash
and that's
key.
How you
so
actually
you
hit the cache.
What's that?
That's how you actually get the content.
So get the content is just like you look up, you take the content hash and you look it up in the cache.
Right?
I'm saying there's like a secondary cache which maps the input hash set,
right.
the node itself.
To skip a function execution.
To return hash.
Yeah, right.
So the return hash, if it's cached out.
Right.
So that you can rip through that.
And that's actually hitting the cache. That's what it means to hit the cache. Hitting the cache means skipping a function execution.
Yes.
Because you had the content hashes of the inputs.
You mapped to the output hash.
And yeah, you skip the function execution. Here's the output hash. I now can execute the next function or not if I hit again.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
You get to keep hopping until you're forced to actually pull content from there.
Right.
From there.
So what that boils down to is everything is the hash.
So that cache needs to be deleted when you clean, right? That cache has to live inside the PANS workspace in PANS.d because otherwise you'll skip through it, but you won't actually pull any artifacts for it.
There's a lot to be said about that cache.
Which actually,
you probably actually want to have a global cache that you're talking to.
I think it's just a cache. I'm not sure about you. Because I decided not to execute this function because the inputs were completely identical. All inputs are declared. Right?
And the function code is part of that.
And the function code is the only thing that is not currently, right? If you pickle the same way, but the function code is different, the Python code that defines the function is different, like that's where task implementation comes in. And then that would need to change your identity. And then you'd miss the cache.
But my point was, but if let's say I clean and then I run this.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say now I compile, so I'm asking for class files.
Mm-hmm.
I could end up with class files, but no generated source files, say, because I never ran code gen.
Correct.
Because I just, which I guess is fine.
Yeah, it's...
You ask for class files.
When you look at what Basil and Buck do, they do this, and it's essentially if I run test :: don't compile anything, fetch the test results from the cache.
And you really don't even test anything.
Yeah, and don't
yeah,
even
so
right. You just fetch the test results.
Yeah.
But in our world, if you clean and then do that, essentially you'll get the end result that you asked for, and it will be
mm-hmm.
correct,
mm-hmm.
but you will not have in your workspace any of the so.
Correct. That's ideal.
That's an internal detail, right?
PANSD is already private.
That's
so
fine.
It's kind
yeah,
of like...
Fine.
Yeah, okay. So I think there's more to explain here. Like, this subject object is just creating a dict. Payu is making it contain a database.
Cool.
And this is typical, like, parse the specs, get some roots. We set up, these are the two subsystems, quote unquote, that are being used here, right? We've got an address mapper and we've got a project tree. Why did we do this? Because functions need their key in order to identify them and then load them later and get them. So these, you end up with these tasks. You create a scheduler with those tasks. The subject object is this dict up here, right?
It's the storage.
So it's the storage. And you, I think Peyu is already going to rename this. This is going to be storage, right? And then the symbol table class is kind of, it's currently how we identify products that are, that users could possibly be aware of. Like, this is a product type that somebody can put in a build file. Therefore, it's...
So it maps those.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure this can be, this dependent, that argument can be deleted, right? You don't... then you start up an engine. This case is a little weird. What this is doing is executing a build request. So maybe a better example is to just look at the visualizer for a second. So visualize build request. This is a tighter example of the same thing, right? You on your scheduler say build request for these subjects. At this point, the subjects are actually literal. They're not hashed yet. And so the point of this step is hash them, content address them, and then make them roots in an execution request. This execution request has roots, which are, it's the roots of your request, roots of the graph. And we execute the request, you visualize the request, which is going to walk from those roots to visualize it. Part of the reason for the roots to be independent is that the graph can contain a lot more, as it currently can when you have target roots. If you think of caching and holding the entire, not caching, if you think of holding the entire graph in memory across multiple executions, you're going to end up with a lot of content that is not related to your current request, right? So the request knows its roots and carries them with it. And the graph could be very large and contain a whole bunch of stuff not related to what you're currently doing.
You just walk up from the roots.
Right.
Just so you won't make the relevant stuff.
Yeah. Right. So, and...
Very similar to now.
Yeah.
To what?
Even now, like you can inject a bunch of stuff in the graph, like,
that isn't relevant.
Because
right.
It's not in the closure of the roots.
Yeah. Right. And so, Chris has a review out that has a long-lived graph and scheduler.
Oh, cool.
In the daemon.
In the daemon. Which means that... For two different executions, the graph will grow larger. The second time you run, it will be, you know, it's essentially a no-op, right? Because the roots already exist in the graph,
yeah.
And they're already satisfied. Nothing has invalidated them, okay? The invalidation bit, we need to still hook up.
In progress.
But that is Watchman saying, this path has changed, and then us walking through the nodes in the graph, identifying ones that consume that path, which is essentially stuff in the FS package, file contents, directory listings, etc., and invalidating those transitively upward. You can, if you invalidate and you end up hit like getting back on the path, i.e., the comment change example, I changed a comment that doesn't actually affect the hash of the struct I dehydrated from this, and so I get back on the path to, I hit the cache all the way back up.
So on,
yeah.
So exp graph here, just to call out specifically, is
right.
The experimental immutable build graph.
Right.
Yeah.
So
this is part of the integration with the current build graph with the new product graph in the scheduler.
Right.
That implements a new graph interface, basically.
Right, right. And so what that looks like, this is calling, it's creating this graph instance. That's a no-op, right? When you create it, it's empty. No, that's not true. The first thing it'll do is it'll try to find any legacy graph nodes. But when you inject specs, what it does is take those specs, those are the subjects of a execution request, and the product that we need for that subject, right? And this might be sibling addresses or something for this directory, third party, JVM. So my subject is a sibling address. Get me legacy build graph node. Now, it's plural because sibling addresses is going to be multiple things. That's where the special case comes in. Like, we recognize that this is something for which we need a legacy build graph node for each of these, each addresses object we can reify from this subject. But that's the extent of the special case. So the spec comes in. We execute the request, which returns the result type, which still exists, and you raise it if it failed. Otherwise, walk through the resulting graph and add it to our current index. This is very recent and will probably change, but this is essentially how you could currently sort of cause more to be parsed. I think it's possible currently for inject specs closure to be called like way deep, way later in front-end tasks. This would cause more to be parsed. So mutable is sort of a lie. But the reason it's not mutable is that it doesn't allow for synthetic targets, right? You can parse more off disk. You can go out and request more off disk, but we don't currently allow you to inject anything.
And this also nets parallelism for build developers in the engine.
Right. Yeah, in the sense that, there's a lot of work to do in the first cut, in John's cut of the engine. Build file parsing was independent. Build file parsing is now very in. What that means is there are many, 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 many nodes, as you've kind of seen, right? Like, each of these is not worth its own process, not even close. Like, it might not even be worth its own thread. And so a big part of what we need to do here is decide which are worth parallelizing. A few examples, and one example is when we get this subprocess node, I mean, that will just be parallel in the sense that it's going to be running as an external process, but you'll probably want to parent it with a Python thread, for example. So like every process node has a Python thread parenting it, if that makes sense. It's not worth multiprocessing for it. So, but essentially just identifying, I think the engine is going to have to identify nodes. And again, there are not very many types of nodes that it wants to multiprocess for versus multi-thread for versus remote.
Yeah, so you need some basic mechanism to even just like tag this.
Yeah.
That doesn't,
right. Or,
And then experimentally we'll figure out which ones to tag.
Because the vast majority of these you just want to run in process.
My first thought too, seeing this was like, this was nice because it dog foods itself pretty much as far back as you can go. Like, it's pretty much turtles all the way down.
Right.
But the end result here is pretty nasty for a task developer, as long as they don't have to look at all.
Yeah.
As long as they don't have to look at all this and be kind of confused by this self-bootstrapping.
But one interesting,
the model's quite nice.
I don't know what I've broken here. This is funny. Okay, we're just going to write all these and then quit. There we go. Okay, so I didn't actually break anything. Let's break something. File system's not. Well, the file system's fine. Let's break, like, merge paths. Did I not save that? Oh, maybe that doesn't. It's probably not used in that. This is going to break
probably
a lot of stuff.
For those two targets.
Yeah, this breaks a lot of stuff. One interesting thing, though, is that you get a stack trace.
Yeah.
Sort of.
You can follow back.
Yeah. Right? I was able to compute the entire directory listing. That's fine. But then, I was not able to compute an address family. So basically, I was able to list everything, but then I was not able to actually compute an address family for anything.
Fancy.
So we listed all directories, but then we weren't able to compute any address families for them, right?
I think I had this data structure when I finished the experiment, but I never added visualization for it. But like this shows you the full chaining back.
Right,
what
right.
Failed and caused out.
Yeah, yeah. Right. So throws end up tomato colored. You can't quite see it here, but those are tomato.
Okay.
I.e. red. This is not red. This is pink.
Pink is what?
It's nothing. So the rest of these are just like
okay.
The colors otherwise are by product type.
You can almost imagine this like actually caching the errors. So
yeah.
you sort of unify the cache to also be your error tracking and stream.
Yeah, and that's actually so for Peiyu, one thing is that I think the cache interface is the step function. For these inputs, this output, regardless of the output type. So it could be waiting, like here's a list of dependencies.
Mm-hmm.
It could be throw, it could be no op, like you cache, but you know.
So you basically you cache the mapping of steps, inputs, outputs.
Yep. And for in the context of this node, because the step function actually has access to the data in the node constructor. So yeah.
But this goes awry if there are like transient errors.
Transient, yeah, for sure. Everything does. So yeah, maybe you don't want for throw to do that, but. I think that's everything. I mean, the depth inference I can show really quickly. Variants are also kind of interesting, but
yeah, we're pretty over our a lot of time.
Yeah.
I mean, you chatting about it, man.
Yeah.
That's enough to visualize.
Yeah. That was great.
So yeah, the big thing you cleared way for there was obviously build file generation.
Totally, and that's the depth inference thing.
Yeah.
I could show that, but compile. What is it? Well, not even build file generation, but inference, right? So this, and I kind of, this is now fairly old. But if you say that you want to compile this target, what it has is just a type inference, type alias inferred Scala, right? You rewrite this into the current build file syntax. What this looks like is inferred Scala files, something like that.
That'll turn into
something like that.
Dependencies downstream.
Right, and so there are no dependencies. There is a dependency in here, which is simple, which is inferred as source Java simple. And how that happens is at the top we needed a class path for every member of this single address. So the address was okay. We got this address; it exists. Get a class path for this target. Scala sources, right? So we needed Scala sources. How did we get Scala sources? Reify Scala sources. Aha. It came from Reify sources needed the address for the node and. Oh, no, I'm sorry. It's needed something else. This is the dep. So Reify Scala sources requests a class path for each address. From imported JVM packages, which is parsed from the file, which going down, it got the file content of inferdeps.scala, and then extracted the imports to get you the imported JVM packages, and then given imported JVM packages, get an address for a JVM package name, basically.
Nice.
And that, but
it's
the
built in the engine.
Yeah.
And that thing is looking at the source and like grabbing out imports.
Yeah, and it's really dumb. But I think the coolest
concept that's cool.
Right.
Yeah, and very much like 73 internal things, I mean, it shouldn't be too hard to get very right.
Right. And I think one of the coolest things is that it is these tasks. It's these 15 lines of task. Now, obviously, paths hooks into FS, right? Because the file system walk happens in paths. But given source roots and given a JVM package name, I know which directories to look in, right?
I will grant you a file system for this example.
Right. yeah. And then given a package name and an address family for each directory, essentially paths, get an address. This is based on just assuming currently that there is only one address.
Per package?
Yeah.
Yes.
Which is not accurate, but you can fix that.
So let's reify.
That's accurate for us.
Let's reify Scala sources.
So reify is given Scala inferred depth sources, which is that inferred depth declaration that we had in the build file. So basically,
so
given that.
So not targets?
Yeah.
Okay.
Wait, say that again? It's sources because it's
dependencies is expressed as a target.
Not this is the planner's universe. In this universe, you have sources. They live on a target.
Right.
They may have been cogened. You know, wherever they came from. Yes. In this case, they were declared in the target. So this line comes from the target.
Right, but when you compile a target, you compile some sources that belong to a target. You don't need the sources of its dependencies.
Yeah, no, that's not. I'm sorry. That's not the line here. This line is just this. Just select given the sources themselves,
I see.
Which came from this file. Right. So, given this object,
right.
That's all. Given that object, and the dependencies. I'm sorry. An address for each imported JVM package. I can reify into Scala sources. So reify Scala sources. You can see what it's doing. It's like
Scala
given the sources and
Scala
all of the addresses.
Sources are Scala sources with an asterisk, let's say.
Right. That please infer.
Yet, please
yeah,
so
it's a marker saying please infer.
Got it. Okay,
and so then the body looks like this, which is take the sources object and just add dependencies to it.
Okay. So now can you show me that build file entry again for the
I've broken
saying,
it a little bit.
What is this saying? This is saying, right, yeah. So it's basically saying depth equals infer them, please, something like that.
Mm-hmm. No, it's there's
saying,
no dependencies list here.
There's
so configurations. This is the model that John has proposed,
right.
which I'm super on board with.
Yeah.
The idea is you don't targets are completely untyped.
Yes,
instead,
right.
They have
yes.
a list of things on them.
Right.
And so, in this case, what this target has is some inferred Scala sources.
So you have to say
this is the inferred
both
Scala
both sources. And
sources. No, it's not because I'm saying explicitly what my sources
are.
Yeah,
sources aren't inferred.
Yeah. So that's sort of. I guess I would expect this to say just sources like any other target, but instead of listing dependencies, you say the inferred dependencies. You're saying
that's what's happening.
That's what's happening, but this is something that end users edit.
Right.
Yeah.
If
so
you wanted to put, so basically, if you want
to say,
the names are
would be
different. Yeah.
This is the
sources are of a magic type rather than the sources are just like any other source and his.
Well, this is exactly how, this is how sources are dependent. So if this weren't inferred, this would be Scala,
right.
comma dependencies.
Right.
So this is different. This is different from how John had started out.
I guess I would expect dependencies to say dependencies equal some magic token that tells me to infer them, rather than just because
maybe.
There's nothing special about this.
Yeah,
infer dependency
theory.
Well,
and especially
yeah, the spelling is awkward, but that's a spelling.
And
in terms of
you may want to specify some but infer others. Like you may happen to know that inferring gets all the dependencies right except one, and so you need to enumerate that one.
But then, how would your special case? Right. So yeah, maybe. But then your dependencies needs to be an object because it might be either a list or it might be some infer,
right.
which has some extra stuff. But the thing is, like, if on inferred, you add to dependencies, it could just be additive. Like these plus whatever you infer.
Okay.
So it could go either way.
Okay.
But
I guess, and then could you also have regular scala sources in this target? You could say, for some of them, I happen to know that the
right inferred work. Now, currently, what would happen if you did that? Well, if you also had scala sources, then that would be, right, some other file or the same
file? No, other files.
Okay.
Other file with explicitly enumerated dependencies.
So,
that work?
Currently, what will not work is if they were two targets, it would work. If you're one target, you would, for the same subject, have two ways to generate a class path, and so you'd explode.
No.
So that's where merging products would come in.
We talked about, we hand waved on that at the last last summit.
And the reason I hand waved on it last time is because I wasn't sure that you could still throw errors in cases where you need to.
Yeah.
Variants are required, and so you can throw errors. So if you don't specify the variant, you get an error. Like required dep has not been specified, or required variant has not been specified for this thing, couldn't generate a class path for it.
So the reason I ask is that I'm aspiring to a future where as much as possible of this can be either defaulted or implied.
Totally.
And it'd be really nice if in a very well-behaved repo, it was always inferred, except maybe the special case was when it wasn't. And so, you'd want to sort of say, be able to say something like, this is a target under the source scala source group, so everything here is inferred scala source.
Right.
Or something like that.
Yeah.
But that's something we can obviously deal with later.
Yes, absolutely. And currently the fact that it selects based on type is one of the reasons why this is easier.
Mm-hmm.
If this were scala with comma infer depths true,
then you'd have to deinspect.
Yeah. Then you'd have to look at properties of objects in order to select them.
Yeah. Got it.
It's not hard, but just
currently
uniform.
I like keeping the conceptual simplicity for now.
Yeah.
Last thing. The implementation of how would you plug in different implementations of this code scala? Like, let's say, your initial one is you're grabbing imports out, but that's not good.
Mm-hmm.
So now you have some cached information about the type, or you use that, or whatever.
Based on the types, I can delete this. If there's some other way to get files content, given file content to get imported JVM packages, I can delete this and use that instead. Because this is given file content, give it imported JVM packages.
You have multiple ways of doing it, that function could
reconcile it. That's a good question. If you have multiple ways to do it,
let's say
variants are one way.
You go copy some external database what the dependencies are because some magic thing's given to you, and if that fails, then you crap out the imports, and if that fails, then you don't know what to do.
Yeah.
I think it's probably fine if just that one function does that resolution.
Right.
I don't think the engine needs to worry about that.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. There's still some there's definitely support for explicitly multiplexing. Like the way this is selected is via specifying a thrift variant explicitly. And so that's explicit, and adding more is fine. It doesn't break things because you've been explicit. How you do that, I am unsure. How you completely replace a built-in task, I think, is literally by replacing it. Having two installed is totally fine.
They'll both run.
If they support merging, then they'll merge. Otherwise, they'll explode. Or if they have different inputs, then you'll only run in the appropriate case, or I don't know.
Cool. I like this a lot. Awesome.
Cool. Okay.
Nice.
Cool time.
Awesome.
There is one other thing I wanted to bring up.
Yeah.
I wrote this cookbook document over the winter break. And I know Benji said he wanted to do something with documentation, but I don't know if this is what he had in mind or not. The cookbook, there's like a Python cookbook, I think, and all kinds of things. It's just